Welcome to Victory Yard and to Schaap one-on-one with the man who beat Babe Ruth, Ty Cobb, Walter Johnson, Joe DiMaggio, and every other member of the Baseball Hall of Fame, the man who was elected to Cooperstown with the highest percentage of votes in history, Tom Seaver. Tom, of all the compliments that have been paid to you, and there have been plenty, that one, being getting 98.8% of the vote the first time you were eligible, is that the highest compliment?
In many ways it is, Dick. I look at it in perspective, in that sense, and I think the mentality of the voters, the writers that vote in the last 10, 15 years has changed. There's been all this explosion in sports television, sports radio, the media, et cetera. And it became a bigger issue of not if you got in the Hall of Fame, but whether you got in on the first ballot. And then they had to top that. It's what was the percentage of vote that you got to be elected to the Hall of Fame. You know, if I'm sitting there in 1992, to put it in perspective, and Henry Aaron is on the same ballot as Tom Seaver, how in the world could I ever get a higher percentage than a Henry Aaron? I mean, that's the biggest argument for that. But it's a great honor. I mean, it's just great to be there. It's great elbows with them.
You honestly don't believe you're bigger than Ruth and Johnson and Matheson? Coincidentally, the man with the second highest percentage of votes in history is Nolan Ryan.
That's right.
And Nolan was your teammate
for
4 years with the New York Mets. You had careers that paralleled each other to a certain. When you first met each other in 1968, could you have imagined that either of you or both of you would end up in the Hall of Fame?
When you're a kid, you never think that. I mean, literally, when you come into baseball, I mean, we were kids. You know, we were 22, 23, we're 23 years old. And I mean, you don't think that. You don't think, well, geez, I can hardly wait for, you know, my career to end in 20 years so I can then 5 years after that go to the Hall of Fame. You know, I can remember when I first started and I was just married and whatever, and I told my wife, I said, I hope I can play for 5 years. At least I'll qualify for the pension. That was the objective. And there are sequences of objectives as you go through a career, and that was one of them. We were on a ball club with a lot of good young pitchers, et cetera. Kuzman and Gentry and myself and McGraw, and we had some people that could throw hard, but you don't think about it, you know. Obviously don't think that's going to happen.
But that first year when you were teammates, you won 16 games.
That's right.
And you knew you were a good pitcher. You had won 16 for 2 years in a row.
Right.
Kuzman was a rookie and won 19.
Right.
Nolan Ryan was struggling.
Right.
Could you see within that, any germ of the fact that someday he would be a great pitcher?
You knew that the physical part was always there with Nolan. The thing about that ball club, when you talk about you had a Kuzman and a Gentry and a Seaver and a Ryan, you got to understand that we all threw hard. We all threw very hard. I mean, I may have gone out there and thrown the ball 98 miles an hour. Kuzman may have gone out there and thrown the ball 97 miles an hour. Gentry may have gone out there and thrown the ball 98 miles an hour. Nolan went out there, and he threw the ball 100 miles an hour. And we all knew that he threw it harder than really maybe anybody else we had ever seen. But it wasn't that big a difference relative to the rest of us.
And he didn't have the control that you guys.
No, he didn't have the control. He was such a raw talent. And the thing about Nolan, that when he was in New York, he was very young, and I think he was in awe of New York. He found it difficult to adjust to New York. He was a young kid from the farm, so to speak, in Texas, and it was difficult for him to adjust. What had to happen to Nolan was exactly what happened to the California Angels when he was traded for Fregosi. He went out there, and whoever was in charge, they said, here's the ball. You're starting every fourth or fifth day or whatever it is. So we don't care what happens. They knew that the physical talent was there, and all he needed was to pitch. He needed to pitch. Now, you're talking about, are you going to break into a staff, when you've got Gentry, Kuzman, and Seaver? Those guys are going to pitch every day. They're going to pitch no matter what. Not only do they have great stuff, but they know how to pitch. So it's difficult. It was difficult, I think, for the Mets and Gil Hodges at that time to say, hey, listen, Nolan, here's the ball. You're part of that. Because he emotionally, I don't think at that stage, he was ready for that. And when he got out of New York, got out of that spotlight, so to speak, and went to Anaheim, which is much, lower keyed environment, and they said, you're pitching every day, and that's it. And it's, of course, his career exploded for him.
Now, at that time, at the very beginning, there was another pitcher who was considered to be almost on a level where you guys were, named Dick Selma,
right,
who had grown up with you
that's
in
right.
Fresno, had pitched against
that's
you
exactly
in high school.
Right.
And here, why did he not make it big while the other guys did? I mean, you've always been a student and, of the game.
Right.
And you knew that he had ability, too.
Right. Oh, he had tremendous ability. Dick always had tremendous ability. He threw as hard as Nolan Ryan, you know, when he was young. And then he hurt his arm. I think that was the biggest part of it. He had an injury. It was elbow. I think it was his elbow or his shoulder. I'm not sure. I don't remember which one it was. And he still lives in Fresno, California. But he had the physical ability equal to Nolan's, too. But he had an injury.
Staff.
But then he went on. He adjusted. He went on and became a decent reliever. I think he went to Philadelphia and Chicago. I think he pitched well in Chicago, too. So he adjusted with what he had. But he had excellent stuff. He always had excellent stuff.
Who was the pitching coach then? And did you guys all talk pitching?
We talked pitching, and we all, probably in a very naive sense, I mean, we were all learning kind of OJT.
Right.
But Rube Walker was the pitching coach in 68 when Gil came over. In 67, Harvey Haddix was the pitching coach. And I think the biggest thing that they did was they gave you the ball. I mean, you learn by pitching, you know, and then you try to dissect your mistakes. You talk about pitching. You learn about mechanics. And as you go through the course of a career, then you intellectually begin to understand what you're doing mentally and physically.
We'll take a break. When we return, we'll talk with Tom Seaver about the glory years in New York with the amazing Mets, the Miracle Mets, the two pennants and the one world championship.
Being that New York was, I think, the press capital of the U.S. and of sports, Tom controlled that pretty good. And when he went out there, he knew what he had to do, and that was to win.
You're taught to be able to throw the ball low and away and keep the ball out of the middle of the plate. And I can't think of a guy that did that better than Tom.
Welcome back to Victory Yard, the perfect setting for one-on-one with Tom Seaver, Hall of Fame pitcher, 300-game winner. Seaver won his first 189 games in 10.5 seasons with the New York Mets, a team that rarely threatened to be even mediocre in its 5 years of existence before he joined the team. Even in Seaver's first two seasons, even though he won 16 games each year, the Mets finished 10th and 9th. Could you have had any idea that the next year you guys would be contending for a championship?
You know, that's one of the great stories about our ball club, and about how a team can mature and all of a sudden come from out of nowhere, be the total of 100-1 odds and win this thing. And it was a series of people getting on board as we went through the course of the season. Jerry Grody actually was the first one in spring training. He talked about us winning that year. And everybody said, this guy's crazy. You know, we finished.
You thought he turned into Choo-Choo Coleman.
Yeah. Said, this guy's crazy, you know. And he said, now we can win, you know, because he looked at what we had. We had Kuzman, Gentry, Seaver, Ryan, you know, Ron Taylor in the bullpen and all, McGraw and all this stuff. And he saw what the potential was. We had a great defensive catcher in Grody. We had Harrelson at shortstop. They made the trade in 68 for AG to play center field. So we had strength up the middle. We had the basic fundamentals of what the game are about. Hodges came over.
This was his second year.
It was his second year. He came over in 68. So 69, all of a sudden, you know, he had this pitching staff that Grody saw was going to come together and could really be something, right? And as we went through the season, through the course of the season, we as individuals began to get on board and said, you know, the guy isn't crazy. And, you know, periodically everybody started to believe, and the thing steamrolled, you know, and by the time we got to, I forget when it was. For me personally, it was a game we played in New York at Shea Stadium. We were playing the Dodgers, and there was a runner on second base. Somebody hit a ball up the middle, bottom of the ninth inning. Willie Davis, which came in to get the ball, and it clearly would have had the runner out at home plate. The ball went right underneath his glove. Runner scored. We win 2-1 or 3-2 or whatever it was. We win those kinds of ball games. And at that point, I said, you know, we can win. That's when I got on board. And then, you know, by the time we got to, you know, whenever it was, we all thought we were going to win.
Well, now in 69, you go on, you begin to believe. First you become winners, then you become contenders,
yeah.
And then you become the National League
right.
champions.
Right.
And now you go into a World Series. And here, you know, you're still a kid, and you're pitching in the opening game of the World Series for a team that's a decided underdog.
Right.
Again, it must all right. seem unreal.
Well, not so much as a lot of other aspects, Dick. And yeah. By the time we got to the World Series, we were pretty confident. We understood that the Baltimore Orioles were the big, bad Baltimore Orioles. I mean, they were on paper regarded as, you know, the unbeatable team. Great pitching staff, Frank Robinson, Brooks Robinson, Belanger and Blair.
A lot of bees.
You know, a lot of, yeah. I mean, a real good ball club. But we had made a trade. Gil Hodges, you know, I think he orchestrated the trade for Don Clendenin, which brought a veteran guy over to our ball club to play first base.
And occasionally hit a home run. Which...
And occasionally hit a home run is exactly right. He had been through the wars, et cetera, so to speak. And we go into Baltimore, and we knew we were darn good. We knew we really felt very confident, et cetera. But you still look at the other team, and you say, well, those are the big, bad Orioles. And I pitched the first game and lost. And the second pitch I threw, Don Buford hits a home run. And we ended up losing 5-3. And I think it was 5-3. But anyway, we came off the field. And Don Clendenin came over to me, and he says, you know what, we're going to beat these guys. And I looked back at the field, and here was the Baltimore Orioles, who were the team, right? And they were jubilant and happy, where in my mind, they should have been, well, this is just taking care of business, and it's not that big a deal. And we went out the next day, and Clendenin says, we're going to beat these guys. We're going to beat these guys. I said, you know, we were in this game. We got hit here or there or whatever, we would have won the ball game. And... sure enough, Kuzman goes out the next day. Well, I mean, you got Seaver on today, you got Kuzman tomorrow, right? Kuzman goes out there, he pitches a no-hitter for seventh. He's got no-hitter going to the seventh inning, and we win that ball game. Then you've got Gentry on the next game, you know, coming back to New York. Gets better and better.
Gets better.
And we thought we were going to win.
And you win the World Series, and you're 25 years old.
That's right.
At the time, and you thought you were going to win lots more World Series.
Yeah.
And that was the first and the last.
Well, you're not...
They are elusive.
Oh, that's right. They're elusive and much more difficult than I think you give yourself credit for when you do win them.
When you're 25, you don't know.
No, you have no idea. But it's any sport.
We'll take a break. When we come back, we'll ask Tom Seaver about his painful break with the Mets and his tours in Cincinnati, Chicago, and Boston.
And there's a long drive to right field. It is up and gone.
You're watching ESPN Classic.
Welcome once again to Victory Yard and one-on-one with Hall of Famer Tom Seaver, a man who led the New York Mets to their first World Championship in 1969. Tom, 8 years later, the Mets traded you to Cincinnati. Can you describe that whole atmosphere and how you felt at the time?
I want to interject something you just said, talking about when you said you're going to continue our talk with Hall of Famer Tom Seaver. And this is a great little story. That Jack Lang, who was president of the Baseball Writers Association, is the guy that calls you and lets you know that you're a Hall of Famer or whatever. And he says, and he called me. I was at home in the kitchen of my house in Connecticut. And he called me and he said, your life is now changed forever. I said, what are you talking about, Jack? He says, because every time somebody introduces you, it's going to be Hall of Famer Tom Seaver. Not former Met, not All-Star, not World Champ, nothing. It's going to be Hall of Famer. And it just happened. I just thought of that story.
It's some of the expletives you used to be introduced.
Yeah, that's right. Well, the others that I've heard called, but yes, that's exactly right.
And you were a future Hall of Famer when the Mets traded
right.
you.
Well, it was I have to regurgitate this, you know, periodically when this question comes up. And I look at it on the standpoint, you either take a negative situation, and I didn't like the guy I was working for, M. Donald Grant, and he didn't particularly like me for whatever reasons. And I don't have to get into specifics about that. But you either take a situation like that and say, well, you're going to make a positive out of this or it's going to be a negative in your life. And it was time for me to go on and play someplace else and get back to where the love of the game was going to be on page one, as opposed to this bickering and all the other stuff, which a lot of it had to do with Dick Young, the journalist in town, too, who was the real, I think, kind of the real culprit behind the whole thing.
And who did not like your politics.
He didn't like me, yeah. He didn't like my politics. He didn't like that I may have had a better, you know, whatever it is. I don't know. I don't know what it is. So, but anyway.
But they should have traded Young and Grant.
They could have.
It would have been better
neither one of them could play.
It would have been better for the franchise.
I think it'd been better for New York and been better for the franchise.
But you still got, you know, as you say, taking the positive side of it, you got some wonderful experiences out of it.
Absolutely.
You got to play with some great players in Cincinnati.
Absolutely. There's no question about that. One of the things, I went to Cincinnati and I went over to ball club and Bench is the catcher. John and I are still very good friends. Rose is there, Concepcion, George Foster, Griffey. Joe Morgan at second base. So I got to play with that kind of team, and that was terrific. And it was, and it got me to a different environment. It got my family to a different environment, et cetera. So they looked at a different part of the country.
And you got your no-hitter in Cincinnati.
Got my no-hitter in Cincinnati, you know, which is not in the, you know, I was asked about that, too. And they said, Ned, you know, cite all your top 10 games you ever pitched. That's not one of them, too.
Really?
It just happened to be a no-hitter, you know. But the experience of playing for that team in that town, playing for Sparky Anderson, playing for John McNamara, et cetera, I've thoroughly enjoyed it, yes.
And then you go to the White Sox, and you
right.
get to win your 300th
That's
game
right.
back in New York City.
Yeah.
Pitching against the Yankees.
Exactly right. That was the White Sox came back to the Mets for a year, and then there was another, you know, turmoil thing, and I went to the White Sox. Well, I went to the White Sox. The best part of it is I got to play in the American League, something I never thought. You come in, you say, well, I'm going to play my entire career for one team. You know, that's it. I'm going to be like DiMaggio, or I'm going to be like whoever. I'm going to play for Williams. I'm going to play for just one team, and that's it. I got to play in the American League. I got to pitch in Fenway Park. I got to see Comiskey Park, pitch in Comiskey Park. I got to have Carlton Fisk as a catcher. All those positive things. I got to live for a couple of years in the city of Chicago, which is a tremendous town. I loved every moment of it. And then coming back to New York on my first try, because my father was going to come trucking around, you know, said I better win this one. The first go-around, I don't want him, you know, with his gimpy knee and his gimpy hip having to follow me around the country trying to win my 300th game. So. But doing it here was very special. It happened to be on Rizzuto's day at Yankee Stadium. There's 60,000 people there or whatever it was. It, you know, I couldn't have orchestrated it any better.
And then, of course, you go up to the Red Sox. You
That's
find
right.
a young kid named Roger Clemens. You teach him how to pitch. And
it was simple.
It's history. We're going to pause. When we come back, we'll talk about life after baseball, broadcasting, banking, and grapes.
Here comes the pitch.
This is ESPN Classic.
Welcome once more to Schaap One-on-One with Tom Seaver, Hall of Fame pitcher and future winemaker. Tom has returned to his roots after more than 30 years on the East Coast. He's moved back home to California. Why?
Return to my roots. Very
returning
good.
To
That's
your roots.
A nice little segue there. That's very good.
Well, I'm an old vintner myself.
Yeah,
right.
I know, yeah.
But what made you decide to go back to California?
I think one of the things you find out where you look where you are at stage in life, and one of the things that I've came to enjoy after retiring was gardening. I love gardening. I've always enjoyed wine. My father was in the raisin business. The apple doesn't fall very far from the tree, et cetera. I've always had interest in wine. Not necessarily. I'm not going to become a winemaker.
Right.
I'm going to grow grapes, and there's a huge difference in those two. And I mind more in the, I would like to raise, you know, a small amount of grapes and then give them to somebody, give them to you, and you can go make the wine with them. But that's what my objective is. The thought of that probably was 20 years ago. My brother-in-law asked me, he says, what are you going to do when you're done? You know, I was probably in the middle of my career, you know. And I said, you know what I'd like to do? I said, probably go to California and raise grapes, because first thing out of my mind. Well, 20 years later, it's beginning to happen.
So well, you had been reading Steinbeck, and you said,
yes,
I've got to
right.
go.
Yes,
you also talked in those days about wanting to paint.
Right.
Do you still paint?
I haven't done any drawing for quite a while, but I do. I used to do some drawing on the road, yes. But that's one of the things on the horizon for me. Yes.
I mean, it seems like such a wonderful balance. The excitement and pressure that you once lived under to the almost bucolic nature of growing grapes and the peacefulness of it.
Well, the peacefulness, but the challenge of it, too. Mm. You know, I mean, in many ways, it's very much like pitching, in a sense. There's a great combination of physical and mental skills, and I enjoy the physical part of it, you know. I mean, we're developing this piece of property out there now, and I'm one of the guys that's out there working, clearing the brush, et cetera, and fire preventing my area. And I was on the... my piece of property and I'm down there and I'm all filthy, dirty and working, you know, and I take my dogs up there and one of the young kids that's on the crew, he comes down and he says, is that your dog? I said, yeah. He says, well, he just ate my sandwich. And I said, that's too bad. And he says, well, do you work for Gill? And I said, no, as a matter of fact, I own the place, you know. And he looked at me and I'm filthy, dirty like this. He says, you what?
Sort of the same way that Lou Brock treated you
when you walked.
Last thing, because just do back to baseball once. You said that the perfect game, I mean, the no-hitter was not one of the 10 best games you ever pitched.
That's right.
The almost perfect game you pitched in 1969, where you had a perfect game into the ninth inning, and Jimmy Qualls, a name that hasn't lived very long in baseball history, got a base hit off you. That moment, how much did that hurt?
It didn't hurt, Dick. As opposed to that, you know, the imperfect game was became a bigger deal than if had I pitched just another perfect game, you know, because it was
just another perfect
game, right? But all of a sudden, with one out in the ninth inning, there's a base hit to left field. You know, my wife is in tears afterwards. My father had started on a business trip coming from California. My wife picked him up at the airport. She wasn't in tears because she had to pick my father up. She picked him up at the airport. He came to that ball game. There were 60,000 fans in the stadium at Shea Stadium. I see my wife after the game. She's in tears. You lost your perfect game. I said, I lost my perfect game. I pitched a one-hitter. I didn't walk anybody. We won 4-0 or whatever the score was. I struck out 10.
You were moving into, towards first place.
Yeah, it was a pretty good game. You know, against the Chicago Cubs, it was a pretty good game. But but physically and mentally, yeah, that's if it's not the best game I ever pitched, then it's, you know, second.
You have a lousy memory. Thank you, Tom. Welcome to Schaap One-on-One with a man who in high school outplayed Lenny Wilkins on the basketball court.